Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the Autoroute Announce feature for routing over an MPLS-TE topology. Networking and telecom can be complex, but I'm here to break them down into simple, easy-to-understand concepts. My goal is to make learning these topics as intuitive as possible, just the way I wish I had been taught when I got started. If this video helps you, don't forget to like, subscribe, and to hit the bell icon to be notified of new content. In previous videos, we created an MPLS-TE topology. We employed OSPF-TE in the underlay network, and we configured MPLS-TE on our P and PE routers. We configured RSVP-TE, and we created our LSP tunnels. Now, this is the topology on which we applied all of these technologies to get our MPLS-TE network to function. Once our tunnels are up and running, however, they don't actually do anything unless we route traffic through them. In the previous video, we took a look at how to use static routing to route traffic down our LSP tunnels. In this video, we'll be taking a look at a feature called Autoroute Announce. This is an MPLS traffic engineering specific feature that enables the TE tunnel to take part in the underlying IGP. Now, someone may ask, why not just add the tunnel interface to our routing protocol like we would do with any other interface? Why not just create a neighbor adjacency between the headend and tailend routers using our IGP? Actually, there are a couple of very good reasons why this is a bad idea. First of all, remember that TE tunnels are unidirectional. An IGP like OSPF, which is deployed on our underlay network here, requires bidirectional traffic in order to exchange routing information between neighbors. So by its very nature, a TE tunnel wouldn't allow that. Secondly, because the tunnel is contained within a single OSPF area, the OSPF protocol already has a full view of what the topology looks like. So exchanging information across the tunnel itself would not add any additional information to the OSPF database. So for those reasons, we need some other mechanism to allow a TE tunnel to automatically take part in routing. This is desired in order to avoid the scalability issues involved with the static routing solution. And that's where the Autoroute Announce feature comes in. Now, Autoroute Announce is a traffic engineering specific feature, as we mentioned before, that you can add to your LSP tunnels so that they can dynamically be included in the SFP algorithm. It's something configured on the headend router, specifically within the configuration of the tunnel interface itself. The result is that any network found behind the tailend router of the specific tunnel will be added to the routing table of the headend router with a next hop via the tunnel itself. These routes, when they're installed in the headend router, are still considered OSPF routes, but they're not advertised to other routers like P1 or P3 here. They remain local to the headend router. So with the configuration of Autoroute Announce on Tunnel 1 on PE1 here, you will see the addition of these routes within the routing table as OSPF routes. This is because these routes are behind the tailend router. Now that we understand what Autoroute Announce is as a feature, let's configure it on our tunnel interface. If you're not sure what we configured so far and how we've configured it, take a look at the previous videos from this playlist to get up to speed on the details of how we've configured this topology so far. So we'll go into our PE1 router initially and we'll take a look at our routing table. Now there's a lot of stuff here simply because all of the networks we see on our topology are included here, both OSPF learned as well as directly connected. However, what we don't see is our tunnel interface as an exit interface for any of the routes. Now let's configure Autoroute Announce on our headend router of our tunnel, which is our PE1 router. Now I've included here the configurations that we have already applied to this interface just for reference, so we remember what has already been applied. To add the Autoroute Announce, it's as simple as adding this last command here. Now notice that this command falls under the tunnel MPLS traffic engineering set of commands. It's a command similar to the bandwidth and the various path options that are available for TE tunnels. So by putting in this command, we essentially tell OSPF that any routes that are learned directly from the tail-end router of PE2 can be routed through the tunnel interface as the exit interface. So what should we expect to see in our routing table in PE1? The MPLS-TE Tunnel 1 will be preferred as the outgoing interface for any destination that's reachable through PE2. So such traffic will now use Tunnel 1 instead of traditional OSPF paths. So the 2.0.0.2/32 loopback address, the 10.10.40.0 destination network, the 10.10.70.0 destination network, as well as the 80.0 destination network, and the 192.168.12.0 destination network, all of these are expected to be seen in the routing table with an exit interface of Tunnel 1. Let's see the results of this action. Let's take a look at PE1's routing table once again. As you can see, indeed, all of the directly connected networks to PE2, as well as the network connected to CE2, are all now showing to have an exit interface of Tunnel 1. Note that these appear simply as OSPF routes, indicated by the O flag here. You can also see that the metric of these routes is only 1, because through the tunnel, the PE2 router is considered directly connected. And the 192.168.12.0 network has a cumulative metric of 2. Now, I won't go into how the OSPF metric is calculated. Suffice it to say here that a value of 1 is given to each link that has a bandwidth of 100 megabits per second or higher. Now, just a reminder, the Autoroute Announce feature tells PE1 about these routes that are reachable via PE2. But PE1 itself does not re-advertise these routes to other OSPF neighbors that it may have, like CE1 or P1 or P3. Now here are the OSPF routes again, but this time we've listed just those routes with Tunnel 1 as the exit interface. Now just a reminder that these routes appear in the headend router only. They are there only for traffic moving from PE1 to PE2 over the tunnel. The LSP tunnel is unidirectional, so any return traffic will have to simply use the OSPF-TE underlay to get back. Now, which routes will actually use the tunnel interface and which will not? How about the 10.10.30.0 network? Why not route traffic via the tunnel and then go back to reach this network? Well, OSPF lowest metric rules still apply. So if you take a look at this metric here, we have 1, 2, and then 3. While going via P1, we have a metric of 2, so this is preferable. We still use OSPF metric rules to determine which routes actually get into the routing table. Now let's take a look at one more thing. Take a look at PE1's MPLS forwarding table. Within it, you can now see the labels that correspond to the new routes that have been installed through the tunnel. You can clearly see the outgoing interface of Tunnel 1 for all these, as well as the point-to-point indicator for the next hop. So that's the use of Autoroute Announce, a feature that's specifically designed to allow a tunnel interface to participate in the SFP algorithm of the underlying IGP. Remember, for MPLS-TE, the underlying IGP can be either OSPF-TE or ISIS-TE. So either routing protocol will work with Autoroute Announce. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope you found this video useful, and I'd like to thank you for watching. Thank you.